So we're going to talk about experiences from election campaigns today, just a reasonably casual conversation. We've got John and I are going to have a chat. We worked together on the Every Australian Counts campaign. I learned a lot from John's strategy, perspective and experience, and I think you guys will too today. But and then we have Paul Oosting from GetUp and Cameron Klose, who I'll introduce a bit later on, who worked on the Voices of Indire campaign, which is Cathy McGowan's 2013 election campaign, quite groundbreaking. So we thought we'd start, so there's some more formal presentations, but we thought we'd just start with a chat with John, because John's been a member of Parliament in New South Wales. And I'm really interested in digging out some perspectives on what it's like to be a candidate in elections, because we'll be talking to a lot of candidates over the year, and also kind of what that experience is like being on the campaign trail. So tell us what it's like being in the eye of the storm, John.
Okay. So the most pressing thing in elections for me in public office was not so much as a local member, but it does apply to local members as well, is the need to consistently communicate something and what that translates to about yourself and about what you're doing, what you want the issue to don't, you know, the thing that every politician from every political party will have been taught by now, pretty well, maybe Clive Palmer wasn't taught this, but is that politics is like, political argument and an issue is like a rugby scrum. Nobody will be taught it in those terms, but it's like a tug of war, a push and pull. So the media want a story, and the story will be something that is probably detrimental, maybe detrimental at least, to your position, because it'll be more interesting if it's minister breaks ranks with prime minister, or local member drops can on minister, or whatever, or you know, candidate repudiates party policy, or whatever is kind of a much more interesting story for a journalist. Meanwhile, for the member of parliament, the opposite is the case. Of course, they've got a specific message. Might be, I support solar. Might be, you know, I support the NDIS. It might be, I'll be a voice for your electorate, or whatever the kind of thing is. And so they will try every opportunity, if they're well-trained or if they've trained themselves well, to ignore the push-pull or ignore the pull of the journalists to drag them to a story and pull the media back to reporting the story they want reported, which is what you want to say about yourself and your constituents and your policies. And the effect of that has now become somewhat, to the delight of the chaser and other media send-ups, is politicians who walk up to press conferences and doorstop interviews and repeat the same sentence 12 times to different questions by journalists, and eventually find themselves in a lot of position. So I think that's the most terrifying thing. One, that you've got to keep your message consistent, and if you don't, you'll find that your message could become something that becomes a detrimental issue to what you're doing in the campaign and what your party's doing in the campaign. But on the other hand, if you stick to your message, you're not being authentic. Undeniably, you're not being authentic, and you risk being exposed as not being authentic. So I think that, anyway,
so
that's a
rocks and hard places.
Yeah, rocks and hard places. That's really. I mean, it's, you know, for incumbent politicians who are seeking to be elected, as distinct from seeking to make a point, nominating by making a point. I think you know, it's the classic, you know, Joe. You know, it's not a joke. Very serious. Wilfred Owen, someone like that, said that, you know, the First World War was long hours of boredom punctuated by moments of sheer terror. And that's what campaigning is like for a politician. Long hours of boredom punctuated by moments of sheer terror when you suddenly realise that something you've said is going to cause a huge problem or could cause a huge problem. And also that you're not, and you have this sort of, you know, existential problem of how do I be authentic to myself, what I really think is important, when I've got all these lines I'm supposed to parrot to keep the campaign on track.
Mm.
we'll just do this for a little bit and then we'll have our other formal presentations, then we're going to open it up to question and answer. The other one thing that presses upon me as an issues-based campaigner is, you've been a candidate where you've been a politician in Parliament where you've been lobbied by various groups, big, small, you know, well-funded, grassroots, or, you know, everything in between. I'm interested in your perspectives on how you can actually show a politician that you are going to be effective in a campaign and influence it, and then prove that you were post-election.
Ooh, that's a hard one. I'll prove my previous point and answer that question by not answering the question, which is I. I think, thank you for that, because that does help me answer the question and actually get somewhere close to an answer to Claire's question rather than avoid it. What it gets back to that example of saying, where is the standing of the, for most people who are candidates in election, especially if they're really trying to win, every group they've got to see, even if it's somebody who's a personal friend of theirs, is a problem. Every group they've got to see is somebody they're frightened of, who's going to come in and make their life difficult. I think it's an interesting proposition that you come in and offer to make their life less complicated and happier by asking them to support whatever you're... So you've got to really reduce what you're looking for down to a kind of fairly simple set of proposals or a simple proposition, and then ask them to support it, ask them to become champions of it. That's what we did. Is that always doable? How do you measure it? Pretty hard to measure it, except that politicians end up knowing more about this than the general public, although occasionally it gets exposed through polls when the issues hierarchy and campaigns changes. That shows relatively how effective a particular group is being in terms of making the issues in the campaign. So I don't know. I think really offering people a solution to their problem is the better way to go. One of the other things, and why I said it before, is that most members of Parliament and almost every candidate from a major political party, I'm not sure if the Greens are doing it these days, but they're probably not far off getting to the point where they'll do it. I'm sorry to offend anybody from the Greens, but they will eventually get to this where they will answer questions by everything will be done in a corporate way. You answer everything according to the corporate discipline of the party. And so that means you have to be a bit sharp. If you want to impact on the individual politician, you've got to think beyond, well, what am I trying to do here? I'm trying to influence this person's attitude to what they're going to do in the party room, what they're going to do at their conference, or that's what I'm trying to get. That's where I'm trying to get to here. I'm not necessarily going to get them to give me the answers I want because the national secretary of their party is going to get some policy wonk to write the answers for them and distribute it to every one of the 190 candidates, and that's going to be the way the problem will be dealt with. But if you try to look beyond that, what are the things that I can get out of this meeting with the MP is probably more likely to give you some useful political capital.
That was kind of where I was coming to with my next question. We might just finish it with this question. When you do have that issue of an unknown attitude at the kind of upper echelons of the party, you know, organisation or the leadership, but you've got reasonable kind of grassroots support or open minds amongst, you know, ordinary backbenchers, you know, we're in the situation where some of those backbenchers won't come forward because they're waiting to see what's happening at the top of the tree. I find that disconnect quite challenging. And the other challenge as well is around when you've got an individual candidate saying, or an incumbent saying, well, I'm fully supportive of all this policy agenda, but it's in direct opposition to where the party ends up. And, you know, how much leeway do you give an individual candidate when they're probably not going to have a lot of power in the party room post-election? They're too, you know, how much do you support an individual's support when they can be hamstrung in that way?
Well, it's a strength in numbers. I think that's at the end of the day, yeah, one backbencher who is a so-called maverick is not going to make a big difference to what the party's going to do. But if there's 10 or 12 or 15 backbenchers who are nervous or happy or angry about something, that is going to make a difference to the way the party will respond, especially if a few of them are in very marginal seats. So if you go back to a really recent example, which is not directly connected to any of our campaigns, the recent GST thing, and all of the GST thing, well, so-called bedwetters, but there was probably about 20 bedwetters at least, maybe 30. And I'm sure that, you know, if there had just been one or two, then we probably have a coalition government committed to going to the GST, going to the election with the increased GST. It would make Scott Morrison's job a lot easier. But, you know, there would have been not two of them, there would have been 20 of them at least, maybe more, who would have just felt it in their guts walking down the street. People hate this idea. It's not going to happen. I've got to tell them. So I think it's a strength in numbers argument. That's why you don't just... And that's why I think I count... I mean, although marginal seat campaigning is still really important and everything else, I also counsel against just focusing on the real marginal seats. You've got to be a bit broader because in the end, they all have a bit of a say on this sort of stuff. And so in the party room, when these things become issues, it's the backbench at large. And there isn't such a big distinction made between elections, between marginal seat members and backbenchers in safe seats.
All right, we might leave it there. Thank you to John. And next, round of applause, maybe. So now I'll invite back to the floor Paul Oosting, the National Director of GetUp, who's going to do a presentation on the Queensland election and that experience there. Would you like a handheld mic?
Sure, thank you. I'm guessing the clicker won't work for me.
Yeah.
Ah, sorry. Thanks. That's my dad, by the way. Just kidding.
Do you want to click?
Are you if this works, I'll use this.
And, whoa, does it work?
Did that work? Wow, crazy.
Technology.
I'm going to come and stand over here. Hi. Does anyone know the tipping point at which an avalanche occurs? That's 38 degrees, but you didn't know that. Why is that relevant to my talk? Well, we were involved in what I would see as a tipping point moment, and it's a really important, in a sense, context or even caveat to the talk that I'm about to give, because what I'm about to give is all about GetUp and the campaign that we ran. But in the Queensland state election, you'll be not surprised to know that so were dozens of other groups, unions, parties, environment groups, and some of them had run massive campaigns for many years, putting issues like the Great Barrier Reef on the agenda or solar. Other groups had very direct campaigns around how individual voters should use their vote in terms of putting the Liberals last. So I just wanted to be clear, because the rest of my talk, as I say, is all about GetUp, but the reality is that GetUp was involved in a tipping point moment and played a relatively niche role, but one I would say was important. I've gone the wrong way. So I guess the other bit of context is that I can gloss over with this audience, I'm sure, is that we'd campaigned, along with a lot of others, specifically on the Great Barrier Reef, the dumping and dredging for the Abbott Point coal terminal and the proposed coal mines in the Galilee Basin by Gina Reinhart and the Adani Group and a whole range of other companies for... Since I joined GetUp, actually, I think we sort of started the campaign in about 2011 when the World Heritage Commission was outraged. And under the Newman government, almost everything we did didn't work. So we started to think, what are the other things we can do? One of the other things we did was take some court cases, some of which were successful, some weren't. But we started to look really seriously, I guess, at the electoral politics, and GetUp's had involvement in a number of election campaigns over the years. While I've been at GetUp for 5 years, we played a role in the 2013 election campaign, then the WA Senate rerun, did some stuff in Victoria. And at every step along the way, we've tried to measure what we've done, whether it's A/B testing how to vote cards at polling booths or other sort of tactics that we might roll out to ensure that we are having impact. And a lot of the time we've come away saying, look, we helped to put an issue on the agenda, or the membership's really grown and getting more powerful, but maybe we didn't have an impact. You know, a lot of our testing has shown that sometimes it's really difficult to crack through. But we've got better, I think, at working out how to do that. So some context. We decided to focus on those seats there because they were marginal. So it was a fairly traditional marginal seats campaign, given, as I say, the context being the Great Barrier Reef campaign. GetUp doesn't campaign for or against political parties. We campaign on issues, and in this case we'd worked on the Great Barrier Reef for a number of years, and the Newman government was at the polar opposite extreme of where our membership wanted to go on the issue. And so we looked to see, in a sense, where they were vulnerable, and these seats are the ones that we decided to focus on. A big part of what GetUp tries to do, and it's something that that we have a long way to go on, is to be member-driven, and it's something we, you know, continue to need to strive to get good at and work out how do we engage a membership, particularly when our number of people that have taken action with GetUp over the years is 1.2 million people, so it's a hard challenge, but we do try and make sure that the decisions we take are member-informed. So we currently poll our members on a weekly basis, and in this case we poll them specifically around what we should do in the Queensland state election. So that one was pretty obvious. 97% of people were keen that we did that. The second question we asked was, would you be in favour of GetUp members handing out how to vote cards as opposed to scorecards? 94% of people were keen. That's not something we would have expected, to be honest. It's a really big figure. In the past, I think a majority of people probably would have said no. In fact, 2013 was definitely the sense. We didn't as explicitly poll on this particular point, but it was definitely the vibe amongst the membership and staff and the board that was probably a political bridge too far for us to provide how to vote cards rather than just ranking on issues. Sorry, I clearly haven't totally polished my presentation. I'm not sure what this next one is. Are you in favour of GetUp explicitly encouraging voters who are in support of protecting the reef not to vote for Campbell Newman? And they were keen for us to do that as well. And again, local context, years of campaigning on the reef issue. So here's the how to vote card that we ended up with. We wanted to give voters really direct information, and it ends up being pretty basic, I guess. There was a few more options in certain electorates where the independents were running. So we would then engage the local candidates who were not the Liberal Party, whose position on the reef, as I say, was very clear and extremely opposed to ours. And we pushed both the Greens and the Labor Party to adopt good positions in relation to particularly Abbott Point, the subsidising of coal companies and so forth. And as a result, we wanted to give voters really clear information on how to use their vote in terms of where their preferences would flow. Because one of the things that we've found really challenging is shifting people who are intending to vote for Conservatives. And given the nature of the optional preferential voting scheme here in Queensland, we decided just to focus on people that were not voting for the Liberal Party effectively and give them some advice on how to use their vote to maximum effect. Because the nature, and I know there's a few non-Queenslanders. Actually, show of hands, how many non-Queenslanders in the room? Oh, way more than I expected. Okay. So optional preferential voting means that your vote can exhaust. So if you were to go in and say vote one for a particular party, say the Greens, and they didn't get elected, then your vote would exhaust and effectively be useless. Same with an independent, and depending on how Labor going in that seat, the same might apply there. So actually where the preferences flowed and whether or not you tick more than one box is really, really important. We, as I mentioned, we focused on those particular electorates earlier, and we were caught unawares by the early election date. We were expecting we'd have another 2 to 3 months to get organised. Didn't turn out that was the case. So we got involved, and we were able to have awesome members volunteer to lead groups of other members at 64 booths, and in total we had 621 volunteers on election day handing out those how to vote cards. I think we distributed 150,000 of them. There's one there. We expected this might happen, and the Liberal Party tried to injunct our how to vote card, or they did injunct it, I should say, and we had our backup scorecard ready to roll out in case we lost the case, but our lawyers were ready to rock, and I think we were in court and out of court within 45 minutes, and we won the case, and the how to vote card was continued to be rolled out to voters. The way that we tried to measure our impact was on exit polling, so we engaged a polling firm to have staff at all of the booths that we targeted, and including booths that we didn't target. So we had, I think, maybe a total of 10 electorates where we had staff doing exit polling, so we had an A-B sample to see whether or not our How to Vote card had any impact. And we saw a 15% in preference flows across the board. That was 11%. I'm not sure why that was included. The text is missing. The text did say 11% preference flows were influenced by our How to Vote card on Greens voters. I'm not sure why there was a difference there between other and Greens, but there you go. So, as I say, this is one of the quotes I was getting at before that is clearly not just down to our How to Vote card, given particularly the union movement ran a very strong put the Libs last campaign, which would lead many voters to preference with that sort of a message in mind. But we saw unprecedented preferencing that's, on election night, Anthony Green, the ABC's resident sophologist, was just blown away. All of his charts when he was trying to call the election were wrong because of the amount of preferences that were being directed and not exhausting. I think the measurable impact was also picked up where, in a sense, we wanted it to be, because we were able to, through the lead up to the campaign, get the Labor Party and, well, not just us, as I say, themselves and other advocates in the environment sector to a point where they adopted some really good policies on the reef. But we also wanted to demonstrate after the election that there was some influence here of the issue we were working on, so we could try and help make sure that there was delivery of those promises. And Stephen Miles, the Environment Minister here in Queensland, said this quote at a conference last year sometime. That's it. For us, we are looking to, really put issues on the agenda first and foremost, ensure that our campaigning is member-led, but also looking for ways to see where we can have impact. And it'll be a very different campaign in this federal election, but there are some of the lessons we picked up from Queensland.
Thank you, Paul. So our next presentation is Cam Klose, who's working for the Australian Greens at the moment, but he's worked as a political strategist and communications manager at the Wilderness Society. But more excitingly and interestingly, before that, Cam was working on Voices for Indo or of Indo?
Voices for Indo.
Voices for Indo. It's described in different ways. So this is the campaign that for Cathy McGowan's tilt at the seat of Indo. The sitting member there was Sophie Mirabella. And I think you'll be very pleased to hear about the really creative and exciting tactics and strategies that were put in place there. So very welcome to you, Cam.
Thank you
for coming, and go for it.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Yeah, so like I said, I'm Cam. I worked on Cathy McGowan's campaign right from the inception of it. And I'm going to talk you through the seat of Indi, because I think that's really important to understanding how the win was pulled off and then how we went about it. So as you can see from here, you can't really see it, but just below there is Melbourne. So Indi actually stretches right down to sort of the border of Melbourne, about 200 kilometres north to the Murray River. So it's a really large electorate, and as you could imagine, that posed huge problems for organising. Has about 100,000 electors, and it's a federation electorate, so it's been there since 1901. It's one of those, original seven, I think there were, electorates. And it's been held by Conservatives ever since inception, except for 1928, when the Conservative member forgot to apply for election. So, it had been considered a very Conservative electorate for a very long time. Sophie Mirabella was elected in 2001 with 63% of the vote in 2004, and in the 2010 election she got about 52% of the primary vote. So, she was unpopular, but in a rural electorate like that, people are very unwilling to switch their vote, and especially to a Labour candidate or someone like that. So going back to when we started the campaign, you have to remember what the 2013 dialogue was like. We had Abbott as opposition leader, we had Gillard and then Rudd. So when this first started, it was Gillard and Abbott facing off against each other, and it was a particularly volatile and nasty political situation, which since Turnbull's taken over has largely sort of abated. But back then it was fairly horrific. So that one jumped out. So what we did, we actually didn't even consider to begin with running a candidate. There were a group of locals across Indi who were really concerned with the political dialogue and felt completely powerless and wondered what we could do. So what we did was we started Voice for Indi, which was a group that essentially tried to bring democracy back to the people. And we ran a series of kitchen table conversations across the electorate where we got people to run structured conversations. So they focused on three themes. I'm not sure if they're up there. No, the three themes were representation, values in politics, and local issues that you'd like to see change in your electorate. Because we realized that nationally, those big issues like climate change, asylum seekers are so partisan. And, there's a partisan, all parties have a partisan stake there. And we realized that, we're just going to feed into that, the sort of yelling from either angle there. So we wanted to really hook it into the electorate of Indi. So the people undertook these kitchen table conversations. There were 450 people who participated in them. And they were as varied as, after yoga or camping in the woods and those sort of things. So there was a real sort of community grassroots feel to it right from the beginning. And then from that, five key issues emerged, which would later then become the platform that we ran on. So it was public transport, health, broadband and communications, environment and agriculture, and quality of representation. So for a rural electorate, they're not surprising issues. What we did then, we actually didn't know what we were going to do. So we thought, we'll take it to the member. We'll take it to Sophie Mirabella. And we had a meeting with her, and she listened to us for about 5 minutes. And said, yep, I don't need to see this. I know what the issues are that matter to the people of Indi. It's cost of living. So with that in mind, we decided we're going to run a candidate because, the sitting member wasn't going to take much interest. So this here is, as I mentioned before, the geography of Indi. This is the northern part of the electorate where the majority of the population, probably about 2/3 of the population, lived in about 1/3 of the electorate. And it was exceptionally hilly. Here we have three of Victoria's snowfields in this electorate, and it's an electorate right here of valleys. So we had no idea how to start. We had no idea how to build momentum or buzz around an issue, and all of us were political amateurs. Like, looking back, we were so naive. Do you think that we could do it? It was exceptionally naive, and the way we ran about it, we had we really had very little political nous. So in many ways, I think that actually helped our grassroots campaign. So we I'm going to come to that in a little while, actually. So we Skyped Tony Windsor's crew, and they were really helpful because their electorate is kind of similar. And they suggested to start with, because they have valleys as well, they said start up the top of the valleys where the towns are small. So you can see Midamida there, you can see Bright there, you can see Whitfield there. So we started our campaign up there. We started with politics in the pub, or we'd have pumpkin soup lunches and that sort of thing. And really sort of community feel and invite everyone down. So in a town like Midder, which has 120 people, 90 people showed up, politics in the pub. Whitfield was similar, like 250 people, about 180 showed up. And people started talking about it, and it was a really easy way in. So, and the thing is as well, with people, in Midder, in Whitfield, in Bright, they also then go and buy their groceries in Wangaratta or Wodonga or the bigger town. So then they come down to the store and, social networks in the country are so very strong. And they'll talk, have you heard about Cathy McGowan? Have you heard about the new candidate? And it built this buzz with us having to do very little and having to actually start talking to very few people. And as you can see, these are rural booths that we didn't even really target that much. Poor Punk and Mirabella had 62%, then down to 40%, 57, 39. So it really, not everyone voted for us, but everyone listened to us. And it started a discussion, it started a dialogue that was otherwise not there. The other part of this, this slide's gone a bit funny, that's fine. The other part of it was we empowered our volunteers because like I said before, huge electorate, the size of Massachusetts, we had a very flat structure and empowered our volunteers to go away into their local communities and actually start groups and start doing things themselves. also, it's true everywhere, but particularly in the country, local networks and local people are, like, social capital is so strong. And if you have local people talking about Cathy rather than people from Wodonga or Wangaratta or Melbourne, it's so much more effective. So we had communications training. We taught a whole lot of people in the electorate how to use Facebook and Twitter, signed them up for it in the process. We had training sessions Tuesday and Thursday nights after work. And a whole lot of older people who'd never used social media came along. And we taught them first how to sign up for Facebook and Twitter, and then how to use it. And they then formed Facebook groups, you know, Cathy members in Wodonga, Cathy members in Whitfield, and started organizing their own events. And we would auspice them and give them the support they needed. But really, it was like very easy for us to just say, okay, we can provide that. You do the legwork and you do the groundwork. And every volunteer that we had to sign our values sheet. So we put that out there. And that was to make sure, because what we were up against was what we perceived to be, you know, poor representation, a lack of values in politics. And we really, really wanted to, this was our main point of differentiation early on, was the values. So we made sure that everyone, as part of all the training sessions, everyone understood the values, they signed the values. And that was really useful later on when dirty tactics started happening. And we could just point to the press, well, it can't have been our volunteers because they all signed this value sheet. And it was really effective. So they're the values there. Oop, not sure what that is. Anyway, this it seems to have gone really funny. But anyway, so this is like an example of a local volunteer, Rex McCartney, who's a local mechanic, you know, comes along and signs up, and then he's out there organizing, you know, groups. So this sort of dovetails in the next section. So we want to make politics fun as well, because at the time politics was very serious. Politics was, you know, adversarial. We want to make it fun and... No, that's quite okay. Oh, that's quite okay. Too much excitement. We want to make it accessible for all. So what we did was we had, you know, we started singing circles, started by actually Rex McCartney, the mechanic. He was a passionate singer. So we got a, you know, a Cathy McGowan theme song, which was From Little Things, Big Things Grow. And singing circles popped up around the electorate. We had a train trip to highlight the fact that rural services weren't going well. And we baked gingerbread cookies and handed them out to all passengers on the train. We had a cash mob, which was where a florist in the electorate was complaining that uncertainty around the election was damaging business for her. So we organized a group of volunteers to, you know, mob her store at a certain time and spent $20 there. We bought her store out of flowers and then walked it up and gave it to an old person's home up the road. So like these sort of fun events that really captured the imagination and captured the media attention of the electorate as well. Because that was another really important element to winning this campaign, because we couldn't cover it all on the ground, but we did have really, really strong daily newspapers that were well read. The Border Mail covered about 80,000 people, and it was a daily, and everyone read it. And then other papers like the Wang Chronicle also did. So we really focused on getting Cathy's brand recognition up there. No, Fairfax. Yeah, they definitely weren't Murdoch. Although, yeah, country papers are different. And I must admit that no Fairfax paper covered us outside the election until a week out, but the Oz, the Australian, covered us really well. So, like...
Probably because you were opposing
Senior members. Yeah, yeah. So, which was actually really interesting. I was a bit disappointed with the other Fairfax papers because I thought we had a story, but they weren't interested. So what we did was we really leveraged the local press, and we want to get as many things for our volunteers to do as well. And letters to the editor in rural areas are read by everyone as well. It really sort of allows people to gauge where politics is at and what the feeling is. So we got sort of letter writing campaigns happening, and over this case of the election, 145 letters about Cathy, positive letters about Cathy, were run in the Border Mail, which is that one. And it gave us a sense of momentum and credibility, which is what we're really looking for out of this. We also would leverage Sophie's name outside the electorate to build our credibility out there, and then bring it back into the electorate as well. By getting a story in the Australian, in the Oz, we could then show the Border Mail and they would run the story, you know, they'd run a story on it as well. So it was at all times a credibility building exercise. We also used the media and social media to help fundraise. So what we, you know, it's exceptionally difficult coming up against such a well-resourced candidate. We think that Sophie probably spent about $500,000 on her election campaign, and about $300,000 in the last 2 weeks when she realized that she was in trouble. Our total amount raised was 173, which is a pittance when you consider that you're paying, you know, a staff person, and then you have to do advertising and everything, you know, compete with advertising as well. So what we did, we couldn't compete there. So what we did was we would try and get organic stories in the local press and in the local newspapers and sort of online as well. You can also see before an election, there's a blackout, so you can't advertise in print anymore. But we coated the Border Mail online orange, which was really, really effective. And we had a lot of response from people saying that that was, you know, that helped with brand recognition before the end of, or before votes were cast. As you can see, in terms of donations, we had 1,120 donors. The average donation size was $105, which is, you know, really low. The largest donation was $5,000, who was from a local Nat who couldn't come out and support Kathy, but wanted to help her campaign in one way. So he gave us a big chunk of money. So social media was where we really created this feeling of fun. We created a page, a Tumblr site called Cats for Kathy, where you know, anyone could make a cat meme because the internet loves cat memes, and, you know, put it up there and would promote it on our social media and would promote it on our Facebook. We also had collaborative YouTube videos. So if people had a, you know, some kids did a Kathy McGowan rap and we uploaded it to our YouTube video so everyone could see it. We had a crowdfunding campaign that we pushed out through Twitter, and we targeted key people outside the electorate, because by that stage we realized a lot of people were really interested and wanted to know how they could help. So we targeted key people like Malcolm Fraser supported it, Tony Windsor supported it, Van Badham supported it. So these people with lots of followers online, so they supported and pushed it to their members, and it helped raise, I think we raised about $25,000 off that. And like that allowed us to actually run, it was that allowed us to run our print ads, that, and we did one email asking for money, and those two things allowed us to run our print ads in the lead up to the election, which was really important in terms of building our credibility and fighting Sophie's negative campaign. Just really quickly, this is just our launch. I also want to say that having launches and forums was a really important way of getting our message out there as well. Our launch was attended by about 500 people, and at the forums, you know, the Victorian Farmers Federation, and there were 9 different forums by different interest groups. So having those forums, and every because it was such a hotly contested election, every candidate showed up. Kathy showed up, Sophie showed up, Jenny O'Connor, the Greens candidate, showed up. Everyone showed up, and everyone's view, like, everyone was challenged, and they had to give responses there. And I take your point, John, about it's difficult because candidates have to get their, you know, they get their policy from head office. But under a lot of pressure like that, Sophie actually buckled a bit. And she caved in and gave a few sort of policy, gave a few policy things away. And I can now see that she, in 2012, she said that a solar farm in Indi was a pie in the sky dream. And now her election campaign and election platform is a solar farm in Indi. So like it can really change. This is just Facebook and social media, and this is our Twitter. So it was really like lighthearted, kind of irreverent, you know, something that people could really get behind and engage in. So, you know, there are these really negative signs. There was an independent can't repay the debt, you know, independents can't stop the boats, that type of thing. And rather than getting angry, we just kind of made fun of it. You know, Kathy acknowledged and accepted the Liberal attack that she's not personally a multi-billionaire. So, like, it was fun. Everyone, like, and that's what people got out of it as well. They got a sense of community. They got a sense of fun out of it. And that's why we ended up with more than 650 volunteers on election day. More volunteers, actually, than we knew what to do with them. We ran out of tasks for them to do, which is quite a nice problem to have. Yeah, I think I'll actually end it there. I don't need to go into digital organizing because I think most people have a handle on that. Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Cam. It's such a great campaign and organising story in a high-pressure, exciting... Yeah. And he got in the newspaper. Wow. Hipsters. So... we're just going to have a bit of a chat now, but I'd love you guys to fuel that discussion. So I can ask a question to kick it off, but I think there's probably some here. So who would like to go? Yeah. Yep.
Thanks all, guys, for your presentations. John, a question for you. Richard Reaver's my name. Particularly in relation to, I guess, controlling the story out in the public discussion and the media, when there's either misunderstanding or either the media or your political opponent directly trying to muddy the waters or throw misinformation or disinformation out there. Just wonder your experience about dealing with that.
Okay. Well, to now contradict a little bit what I said before, I think one of the reasons you get trapped is that, you know, that classic send-up of the politician, which is not a send-up, that actually does happen, has happened recently to a public servant in New South Wales, I think, got clocked saying 52 times or something, the same sentence to the media pack. But there is actually a much better way. There's a much simpler way to handle that problem, which is to actually answer the question as skillfully as you can and then bridge to a sort of catch-all point that communicates, you know, a key point about your campaign. So I'll go from a live example. So I didn't talk about before that two of the kind of things we boil down to counter the negatives about the NDIS being good idea but pie in the sky, too big to pay for, blah, 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 blah. The two things we used to say, and they end up having lots of permutations, were to talk about the cost of doing nothing. So the Productivity Commission had kindly costed what the cost of going forward of keeping the disability system the way it was and the impact on the criminal justice system and the health system and the mental health system and the drug and alcohol system of continuously forcing people out of the community into, you know, other forms of inappropriate institutional care. So we would bridge to the cost of doing nothing. So that would be a key message about our campaign. So you'd salvage something out of the communication. Another one, you know, was that, you know, the NDIS will not only save the budget money over time, it will actually improve the productivity of the economy because carers and people with a disability will get the opportunity, the choice and the opportunity to work. So choice and opportunity were two of our key words. And so the cost of doing nothing and choice and opportunity to work and contribute to the community were the kind of ways out of being cornered on what was our main negative. Now, it's a bit of a different situation oftentimes in other campaigns, but if you know already in advance what your principal negative is, what the media will want to know about you and what they'll be wanting to criticise you about and what your opponents will, or people who oppose your values will want to attack you on, then you really have to sort of structure what are the ways with integrity to answer those points, and they become your bridge every time you're cornered by someone asking you a nasty question.
I can add to that. So we all know that the world is turning a particular way, and, you know, the transition to renewables at a global level will happen. It's inevitable, and that's the kind of bridge that we would use to get back onto the kind of popularity win-win-win benefits of solar and renewables. So that's the kind of way you'd handle that for our issue. Did you have something to add to
that? Yeah, I'll just really quickly add as well. We had a problem during our campaign where in a forum, Cathy was misquoted as saying that she was pro Coles and Woolworths, and in a farming electorate that was really damaging. So what we did as well was because the problem is with these sort of myths and misquotes, if they stay, if you don't fix them up, they'll just keep being repeated and repeated and repeated, and it's going to become a part of the narrative. So what we actually did was got the real quote, sent it around to every news organisation, and made sure they had the genuine, you know, the real quote. And Sophie kept trying to make an election issue, but it just didn't bite because we'd sort of killed it. Whereas I feel as if we hadn't, it would have just kept perpetuating. It would have been a real momentum killer for us. So I think that's really important too.
Next question, Sally. I'm hearing that within your campaign that you've gone more of a Teddy Goff and Tyson Shareables route rather than what will be a field campaign.
Yeah, we did use Nation Builder, which was really great, especially in terms of getting our lead volunteers and lead organisers in different towns. We actually didn't have win numbers because we didn't think we were going to win. We actually realistically didn't set out to win, and about 3 weeks out, we started thinking that, oh gosh, we probably actually can win. We got some leaked Labour polling that showed us in with a pretty good shot, And so that's what I'm very naive, like no win numbers with that sort of thing. We had rough win numbers that we were going to have to win Wodonga and Wangaratta, the booths in the biggest two towns, and they're also the most progressive towns. And we knew what sort of, you know, we knew who the persuadable voters were. You know, they were soft Liberal voters, they were Labour voters, they were Greens voters, they were independent voters. And we cleaned up all those categories. So we knew who we were appealing to. We knew who our audience was, but we just didn't know exactly how many we were going to need. In the end, we got 33%. Sophie got 46%. And as you can see, she got no preferences. We got all the preferences. We didn't preference, which was a choice that it was actually a really difficult choice for the campaign to make. But we felt that if we were to preference, would have compromised us as an independent candidate. B, would have opened us up to political attacks if we had a preference, say Labour Greens, or, you know, we didn't preference. We didn't hand out preference cards.
So that meant that those preferences came over really based on your campaign.
Yes. Yeah.
Your campaign on
Yeah.
Second preference.
Yeah. Actually, we actually got across because of Palmer preferences. Palmer heard about Cathy, and Palmer preferenced us, and they got about 4% of the vote, and we got all their preferences.
And
yeah, they're actually great friends, Kathy and Clive.
We've got a question up back for the recording.
Hi, my name is Gillian. I guess I've kind of got two types of questions in here. One is Paul, in your example, talking about the state election campaign. Since then, the Labor Party has, EIS is saying that the state-owned North Queensland Bulk Ports Corporation will carry out dredging and construction, and the government offered to bankroll Adani without guarantee. So I guess this, you know, the promises made in the lead-up to election and then post that and making them stick. And my other question really to everyone on the panel is, Paul, it's been great to hear from the successful campaign you ran, excuse me, but it sounded like it was very much about, you know, strength in numbers of getting to as many MPs as possible. So many different organisations are, you know, doing this marginal electorate campaigning. What's an example in Australia that you can give, or any of you can give, of a marginal electorate campaign that has really been successful and really worked either on a state or federal level?
Great, thanks. So I actually forgot to mention in my slide the outcome of our research, which was silly of me because it was sort of the point of the presentation, I guess. But our research showed that we influenced the outcome in determining who won the seat in four of the seven electorates that we targeted, and maybe more, but four definitively. And yeah, like, I think, you know, you're dead right in your analysis there. I was just discussing earlier, there's just some real challenges with where those promises have gone. There's some challenges with what we asked for as well, if I'm to be completely frank, within these four walls. You know, I think we could have asked for better stuff, and we could have done deeper policy work in the lead up. And from a GetUp point of view, we actually really really lacked the capacity to follow through after the election as well. I don't know where we sat actually on the spectrum. I think we had split views internally as to whether or not the election campaign could be won, for one thing. So there were split views on why we were getting involved. It was certainly partly to see if we could influence some of those seats. But there was, you know, the views around whether or not Campbell Newman was going to lose were very very mixed, I guess, in the lead up to that election, and certainly the mainstream view was that he would absolutely win. And so I think that is in part my excuse for the lack of capacity that we'd built into the system to keep campaigning in the months and weeks afterwards. We literally just didn't have the bandwidth as a staff base. We didn't have the funds to keep people employed, for instance. We, I think, employed maybe 12 people for 4 weeks to run that campaign, and that was it. And so we found it very difficult to follow through. But we have, I think, and we lost a couple of months, which were some crucial months. And I think we've tried to do better since then to continue the pressure and the relationship building with the Queensland government, because we also lack the relationships, which were also key, I think, to ensuring that follow through. But the other thing that I would say, which I think is true, and is that I think we made some other decisions, we in a very broad sense of the term, as in the whole environment movement, around what to campaign on in the lead up to the election 3 years earlier. And what we campaigned on predominantly was the reef dumping and dredging. And the stuff where we have lost the most ground is on coal, for instance. And we hadn't campaigned on that in the public domain. We hadn't really created the political space. And sometimes politicians use that as a cop-out, but I actually tend to agree with them. Like, we hadn't really shifted the public mood or shifted the dial on the issues of fossil fuels and coal in Queensland. And so there was also this a bit of a disjunct that we sort of won all the stuff on the dumping and dredging, but we actually hadn't dealt with the heart of the problem in terms of the subsidies and the support for the coal industry more broadly. So it was easy, therefore, for us to lose traction both externally and internally in our efforts post-election.
I'll just talk really quickly about an election campaign that I think was good in marginal election, in marginal electorates. In Victoria, the last Victorian election campaign, the Wilderness Society and other groups ran a Great Forest National Park campaign targeting marginal electorates in outer northern Melbourne, where it was, we suspected that Labor were going to pick up seats, and managed to get, during that campaign, a promise from Daniel Andrews, who's the incoming Premier, to set up a task force. And, you know, it's difficult after the election to make sure that promise is kept, but since I left the Wilderness Society, I see that the task force has started, and that election campaign was very successful in getting the park, or the promise for the task force.
Just very quickly, one answer to that question is that marginal seat campaigns, a campaign that deploys marginal seat, what I call marginal seat strategy against a campaign that doesn't, if all things being equal, the marginal seat strategy seat will outpoll them by 10% of the vote any given election. I think the answer to what you're asking is internally, John Howard got didn't get a majority of the vote, but got a plurality of electorates, basically because the campaign that he ran managed to hold up in the Liberal seats, the Liberal marginal seats. And so that's basically, I suppose, a marginal seat campaign in the context of the Liberal Party, which was successful. And, of course, in the ALP stroke Labor movement, so it's kind of the ALP plus also the extended Labor movement, the two Rights at Work campaigns, the original Jobs Not GST campaign and the Rights at Work campaign in 2007, clearly made a big difference increasing the vote in marginal seats, and probably at least one of those cases made the difference between winning and losing. So I think there's little doubt that it works. If you're talking about externals, well, I'd probably quote that first campaign, the Jobs Not GST campaign, where the union movement was virtually external or took a position external to the Labor Party and ran a campaign separately around the issues. And I'd say that was a very good example of even though they were still organically connected to the ALP, an external group running a campaign that very much influenced outcomes in marginal seats.
Did you really quickly?
I will be really quick then. For us, maybe calling it a tactic is too small a word, but because there's certainly big strategic interventions we make around elections, but I would like to think that a lot of our campaigns would see election as just one intervention and hopefully a longer cycle to win. And certainly the case on the reef, you know, we've always seen the ways that we would win in the courts and in the finance markets, and actually had deliberately deprioritised elections, and that is another one of my justifications, I guess, for those electoral promises, that it was like third on our priority list in terms of the state-based politics.
Yep.
And just to quickly add, the Your Rights at Work campaign was extremely effective, but wasn't locked in post-election. All those community groups kind of trickled away, and the ACTU built an enormous email list that then wasn't really used again for at least 3 or 4 years. So that's certainly, or those lessons are certainly, you know, front of mind for me in my role. So we have a question up here, and then Jack, and then this fellow over here.
Hi, Trevor Beryl here. I've got a question about how do you
evaluate the candidates that you're going to back? Because, you know, they can have the right values and be supportive of solar, for example, but once they're actually in power, they've got to have some really good skills. They've got to have, you know, good communication skills, good negotiation skills, good critical thinking and strategic skills. They may not have all of them, but they've got to be able to call on people that can at least guide them. So, you know, the process is not just about getting someone in power, it's about someone who can actually change things and work to the future, to the sort of vision that we're looking at. Now, how do we make sure that that happens?
You'd like that one.
I'm going to answer a different question. I'm going to answer the question that we've been thinking about a lot is how do you determine the values and the positioning of the person that you target? And that question came up for me a lot following the leadership change, Abbott to Turnbull, and there was a nice little table that was printed in The Australian of who voted for whom. And so when the polls or, you know, everyone loves Turnbull occurred, it was sort of like, geez, marginal seat campaign doesn't look like an option anymore. It was the initial thought bubble that I had. And then sort of got to thinking about things like the ETS, right? Turnbull said, let's have an ETS, and then got rolled and it didn't pass, and realising how close those factions are within the coalition itself. And so another criteria that we've been trying to think about when we look at a marginal seats campaign now is not just who's the most marginal, but also what's their power within the party. You know, are they from the right faction? Are they from the left faction? Are they powerful or not powerful? And obviously the most powerful people are typically in safe seats, but it's not always the case. There's some interesting people that are in marginal areas, one of them in an area that's in the past been held by an independent, the deputy prime minister. Or is he deputy yet? Sworn in? Yeah, so the Barnaby Joyce I'm talking about. So it's interesting, just another layer of, you know, so I think, you know, you're raising a valid point, but that's where our thinking has been at recently, not just to look at the polls and the numbers of any particular seat, but look at who's there and stands to lose, and are they the worst of the worst, or are they sort of irrelevant, or could they actually be good even if they're in the coalition? There's some people there that are pro-renewables and would want to work with us on these issues.
Could I just add to that before I jump in? We know there's a lot of people within the coalition that are supportive of renewables. Like, we know that. We've talked to them. They think solar's fantastic, and I made the point earlier today that there's huge scope for bipartisanship. But I think the missing link for us is that we're not quite sure where the leadership sits on specific areas of policy yet, and that's where the real opportunity is in that policy space. So, there's some assumptions that we're kind of making around the new Prime Minister's track record, but I think they are assumptions and we need to test them, and this period is a really good opportunity to do that, and that will influence the way that the parliamentary party, the Liberal Party and the National Party operate post-election.
Can I ask a question that's related to that? Because it relates to what you just said too.
Well, we've got two other people waiting for questions, so just hold fire, there's still lots of time.
Oh, the only thing I'd say about, I've got a bit of experience from, so I'm involved in, completely different to everything we've discussed today, I'm involved in harm minimisation campaigning, and I'm still the chairman of National Family Drug Support, and one of the things that they're doing is starting up, and this is a frustrating thing, because in harm minimisation, it is very much although basically most people in the Greens and most people these days in the ALP are likely to be harm minimisation supporters, the coalition is very patchy. And so one of the things that they're doing is starting up sort of a, you know, like amnesty, parliamentary friends of amnesty, parliamentary friends of various countries, whatever, all those sorts of things, and parliamentary friends, you know, parliamentary friends of solar, I suppose. You give people a kind. I didn't know anything if I'm giving Claire a free ad, but the idea that people have a solidarity that goes beyond their party is also useful and helpful. It gives them a bit of Dutch courage, and also I think, you know, makes it clear where people are underneath the kind of veneer of party discipline.
I think we had Jack, yes.
Jack Gilding. I'm interested in transitions in organisations. So I guess all of this is directed to Cam, and there are three interesting points in your story. I guess the first one is, how did the group get together? You know, what was the catalyst for a bunch of people to get together and decide to do something about particularly the political climate. The next interesting transition that I'd like to hear more about is the decision to appoint a candidate, to choose a candidate. And then the third one is, once she's elected, how does all that structure and communications and contacts that you've built up get used post-election?
I'm so glad you asked that question, because I forgot to mention that in my talk. Okay, so the 12 of us who actually started, it came out of Kathy and her family having a chat about politics. And Kathy's nephew and niece said, hey, you know, this is, you know, the political situation in Australia at the moment isn't great. What can we do about it? And Kathy then got together a few of her networks. So it was local networks, essentially, who came together and had this, you know, 12 of them who had this conversation and decided to form Voice for Indi. In terms of choosing to run a candidate, that was difficult because we knew the person we wanted was Kathy, but she didn't want to do it. She was really opposed to it. She thought it would harm her reputation in the local electorate. And going up against Sophie Mirabella, who had, you know, she was quite a fierce warrior, was, you know, it was a difficult one for her to consider doing. But they went through a vetting process. There were three people who applied. We ran ads in the local paper asking for applications. Three people applied, and Kathy ended up getting it. No family members or friends were on that board, so it was a completely neutral panel of people who chose, and they were assessed on values and what skills they'd bring to the role and previous experience. And in terms of afterwards, I'm so glad you asked that question, because the networks have remained really strong, actually. While Kathy's broken from Voice for Indi, the community networks that were forged during that time have stayed really strong. And we've seen things like Watch, which is a climate action group form in Beechworth, which was one of Kathy's key towns. Yakandanda has pledged to go 100% renewable by 20, I'm not sure when exactly, but they've pledged to go 100% renewable. There are community gardens that have started up. In Albury, there's a refugee network, like an asylum seeker and refugee network. So it's really sort of empowered the progressive movement in that region. Indigo Shire has also passed banning CSG. They got within one vote of a green mayor, which is in a rural electorate, is really rare. So those networks stayed together and they felt empowered. Like after Kathy won, they really felt empowered. And, you know, just having Kathy's support as well, because she offers support as well as an MP, has really helped sort of grow those networks and taken it out from, because so often in the community, we expect politicians and parliament to solve our problems. And part of the campaign was also showing that communities can fix, you know, it's up to the communities to fix the problems in their local area. And that's sort of living on, and it's, yeah, really fun to watch it happen.
Hi, my name's James Harding. I'm from Armidale. I recently bought a house there after living in Sydney most of my life. So I've gone from having John Winston Howard as my local representative to having Joe Hockey as my local representative. Uh-huh. And now I have Barnaby Joyce as my local representative. I've done really well. My question is to Cam and to a certain extent John. With all respects to John, I don't think a Labor candidate would have a lot of hope in pulling off Armidale. Tony Windsor, on the other hand, I think would have an excellent chance. He's also already been the local member there. So my question is, how do we get him to get off the fence and throw his hat into the ring?
I hear GetUp running a petition, are they?
We've been surveying our members in the local electorate. Yes. I don't know if you've received it. Yeah. So we, a bit like it happened in Indo, we've had a bunch of members out there asking exactly the same question. And so we wanted to see to what extent GetUp might be able to play a similar role to Voices of Indi, in a sense, I guess, because we've campaigned a lot in New England, actually. Funnily enough, when I joined GetUp, I spent 4 weeks out there on our coal seam gas campaign and hanging out with farmers and so forth on that issue to try and understand it better. And we've worked with them a lot since. So we actually have quite a lot of members in New England. And so at the moment, on the weekend, we launched a survey to get a sense, because we don't want to sort of, you know, plow right in. We have our views on Barnaby, but we wanted to get a sense of where the local members and where the electorate stands on the issues and take it from there, I guess, depending on where those results are. I honestly don't know what the results are. The survey only went out, I think, yesterday. So we'll just...
Ah, oh, great. vote early, vote often.
Yeah. Just really, really quickly, there's also, I think, the New England Network or something that's spread up, which is supporting the idea of a rural candidate. It may or may not be Windsor. I suspect that, to be honest, he just likes poking Barnaby and watching him squirm a bit. I'd be surprised if he ran again. Being an MP, as John will probably tell us, and I'm sure his experience, is really exhausting. It's a really difficult job. And I'm not sure whether he'd want to jump back into it, but just like keep that community network there and keep building it. And if he sees that there's that sort of ground level of support and people who can be mobilized to, you know, start a campaign if he does step up, that would really, I would imagine, help sway his thinking.
I mean, I just would add on the way through, just...
Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, name recognition. Yeah.
I was just going to add the community thing. I mean, there are a bunch of other independents who've held that seat in the past, and both at state and local and federal level. So I think, to Cam's point, I think the community network is really crucial, actually, to have a genuine local grassroots presence.
Yeah.
I think Tony Windsor actually supported a local independent against Barnaby the last time, didn't he? I'm not sure how the local independent went. Yeah, there you go. Okay. So, but I'm pretty sure he wouldn't have just supported anyone. So you may have some worthwhile people around there. But anyway, my question was going to sort of related to what Trevor had asked and what you were talking about earlier. Which you've all touched on, and you've talked on it in relation to a candidate, but... everybody's talking about what happens approaching people, as a lobbyist or whatever, to approach the public or approaching a political party. And I was wondering, with approaching politicians, is there, and I'm sure you all have done it, but no one's explicitly talked about it, is there a value in knowing how policies are created through parties? And I'm sure different parties would have a different way of doing that, and it possibly changes over time. But you've talked a little bit about people who are once they're in power, if you can build up the support from other backbenchers or other people so you get the numbers that way as a lobbying group, because most of the people in the room probably aren't going to be political parties running candidates. They're probably going to be trying to lobby on issues. So as an issues-based thing, if you're going to target people to try and get your issue up, is it worthwhile? I was talking to someone who was a member of Young Labor who was saying, oh, yeah, well, it was great because at the conference we got certain policies, you know. So as a platform to build up the other lobbying that you're doing, is it worthwhile knowing the strategic thinking of, or can you strategically target other people to build momentum for your own case, I suppose?
Yeah, I'm going to jump in first here because I'm going to. There's two things there. The first thing is like there's when you're planning a campaign, you'll have a target, you know, you'll have a target on the change you want, but you also have the decision maker, the primary target. Yeah, you've got to identify that person and then you'll do an exercise, whether it's a long series of discussions or consultations with folks or a big, like, formal stick paper up on the wall and actually map that out. Map out which, you know, people, organisations, networks influence the decisions that person makes and actually crystallise that and then prioritise how you're going to get to that person. The second thing is, yes, parties have different processes for forming policy. There's a particular process through the national platform development process that the RP has, and John could tell you many, many war stories about that process, and you can if you'd like. But then there's different processes that the other parties employ as well, and like various caucuses or grassroots committees, or it's very top down. I feel like I should caution everyone against paying too much attention to those processes and being held captive to them. I think it's really important to go, well, this is what we want. These are the primary decision makers and aim towards that goal, because I've found in my experience that often politicians will say, well, we couldn't possibly do that because we've got this long process and it's going to go back and forth. And, you know, if you follow that, you'll possibly lose time and momentum. It's I reckon it's worth looking at other strategies. But, yeah, anyone want to talk about policy?
Yeah. Well, it's already happened. So you can't really influence it now. And I think, yeah, just further to Claire's point, and I won't speak for too long on it, but in general, policies these days, the outcomes of party conferences, and I think this is pretty well true of all the major parties, and also I think becoming truer and truer of the Greens as time goes on, are much more general. So they're occasionally, for internal reasons, where people want to sort of nail things down, they get quite explicit. You know, you either favour uranium mining or you don't. You know, but that's pretty rare. Much of policy is done in the general. And so, you know, in terms of the party policies, where you are on most of your issues, I think the party policies are where they are and they're going to be where they are until an election. The question is how much you can wrangle in the areas where there's little or no real clear statement.
That actually is a plus for all the people who are trying to target them, because that means that there's a degree of flexibility there.
Yeah, so flexibility either way.
Yeah.
I mean, I was just going to emphasise the point that I think, and it sort of goes to the challenges that we face around the Queensland state election, that I think it's the important thing to focus on is the building of the power, and in this case, people power, the power within the community to sway the politicians, because these things can get really sucked into vortexes internally. So it's certainly great to understand those processes when they occur and so forth. But, I think where we need to build the strength is on in the external, and when we have that and we have it to the high enough degree, they'll call us.
Peter, then Shay. Sorry, Peter, just got in before you. It was line ball. We have time.
Thanks for that. My name's Peter. I'm a solar citizen activist, but also a Labor Party member and activist, and can answer that question that you asked as well. I think it's interesting, and my question is about the Reef campaign as well, having been on the inside of the Labor Party campaign that helped make that an election issue just as much as GetUp did. The policy was set before the election in January last year in the state conference. There was a sort of a move towards banning dumping, but nothing as explicit as what was in the election policy. The work that we did on the inside as Labor Party people to change that policy and get it to more what was being asked of all groups from civil society was quite good. But only came at the very last minute and only because of community pressure. So I wanted to echo that. But my question actually is for following on the same sort of segue about building that community power, that people power within the parties themselves. And I'm only aware of, obviously, from the Labor Party point of view, but the Greens espouse that grassroots democracy where people, you know, the policies are made democratically by the people, that sort of thing. Liberals have their party membership, but doesn't really seem to be activated around any issues. My question with John, I guess, is about the how much with the campaign, the NDIS campaign, how much that growth of the people power within the party helped, especially from the Labor Party side of things, win that campaign and make it a policy permanent issue, because it wasn't a formal, from my recollection, but obviously you were in it, it didn't strictly go through the formal party process first. It was sort of more of a groundswell of party members that wanted that, that helped then influence the Labor Party.
Yeah, look, I think the NDIS is a very interesting, probably would someday make an interesting case study if someone to do the put in the effort to do it, but basically all of the states who had responsibility for disability went through various permutations of realising that they couldn't run a system which was adequate, and that the systems that they had in place were either deteriorating or standing still when the pressures on them was going forward. So first of all, the idea of it, disability being a national responsibility was something that really happened quite suddenly and not been on any party's radar really or anybody's radar, but you'd have to give some, this is not an ad for Bill Shorten, but you'd have to give some credit to Bill when he was the Minister for the Parliamentary City for Disability Services. He gave it a real, someone else would have said, red hot go. So it was a bit of a combination of a top-down, bottom-up process. So once, because I never mentioned that I suppose the other explicitly convenient thing in terms of the problem-solution argument with the NDIS campaign, the Every Australian Counts campaign, is that the Productivity Commission, and prior to that I suppose the Cabinet, had given us the solution. So we didn't have to dream up a policy that was the solution. It was worked out for us by the Productivity Commission, which is a bit of an oddity, I know, but it was in that particular case. And so that's the top-down part of the process. And then what happened is that, the various leadership bodies that had some kind of, membership, indirectly, in some cases directly, membership-based disability organisations kicked off the campaign. And it sort of became much more a people-driven campaign. But the parties came on board, I think, as the...
I can answer that. So, and the kind of famous anecdote, well, I think it's a fantastic anecdote, was wasn't it Bill Shorten who issued the challenge to the sector that said that they'd been kind of arguing and talking about what they could do to fix up the sector for three decades? And he said, well, if you can, work out the 90% of what you agree on rather than focus on the 10% of what you disagree on, I will actually support you and champion this issue. And that was a real tipping point, wasn't it, John?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, jump in. Yeah. I'd just like to say it's awesome to get three different, very different perspectives on what you've done. It's cool. Question is, you suggested, John, that an alternative approach at the moment is actually to go and offer to provide solutions to local candidates as a way of giving them a bit more wiggle room and way out. I'm interested, how do you think that would work with solar? And I'm also interested in your perspectives on that as a solution, as an alternative process.
Yeah, I suppose I haven't really got developed thinking on that, but I would say that the key thing is the number of people in each electorate. I mean, we discussed this in the breakout forum before, the numbers of people in a lot of electorates that already utilise solar, and the number of people whose employment depends directly or indirectly on, solar installation and all the spin-offs. I would think that would be, the first lever in, because...
Sorry, just to clarify, is that in actually saying, hey, the solution is we've got this block of votes that we can bring
in?
Well,
block of votes would probably be, I think you'd be overstating it if you did that, but you can sort of hint at that without kind of overstating it.
Yeah.
They're voters. But I think it's more to that kind of try to get... as I said, politicians are fatigued with being bashed up about, the numbers and, we'll take your seat off you and all that sort of stuff. Someone saying to them, well, you got into this. Unbelievably, most people go into public, I think it's alluded to before, most people go into public office for the best of conceivable reasons. Even people who you'd think of as bastards and idiots, most of them actually go in for the best of motives, but... oftentimes they're fatigued out of that after a couple of terms and become pretty cynical and sceptical. Basically, they're looking for an it might be a bit romantic on my part, but I actually think many people in Parliament are looking for something to be positive about. And of course, your first opportunity to have wriggle room or break with your party room, not necessarily break with it, but have wriggle room within it, is an obligation to your electorate. And parties, more than ever, will give a leave pass to a marginal seat member who feels they have an obligation to their electorate. So I think, look, that's not really an answer to your question, but I think that's the general place the answer to your question resides.
Can I quickly add to to that with Solar Citizens' work. We're unabashedly political, but we're also unabashedly independent. So we have said across the board, if people do the right thing, you know, we're more than happy to give you a big tick. We gave Clive Palmer a really big tick when he came out in support of the full renewable energy target. Got a lot of blowback from our supporter base, you know, around, you know, online and things like that, because, you know, how could you support this particular individual? And, you know, I think it's, if we're aiming for bipartisanship or multipartisanship, as John refers to, we have to continue to, you know, be fair and recognise when people do good things. So did you have additions to that question? We might have John, and were there any other burning questions? Because we're coming up to time. Okay, Sally, John, then Sally, and then we'll wrap up.
Okay. Look, following on from that, it occurred to me, do we know how many politicians across the country have solar? We know that Campbell had solar. Nobody actually went and said to him, why do you have solar? What are the benefits of having solar? Is it a myth? Are you one of those latte-drinking, champagne-sipping bastards who are taking money out of the pockets of pensioners to support these, you know, middle-aged old dickheads who can afford to put solar on their roofs? Can we go at it that way?
So to directly answer your question, because I think I'm most qualified to, John's referring to a quote from the former treasurer of Queensland, Tim Nicholls, who referred to solar owners as latte sippers of the champagne set. And it caused much outrage amongst certainly the solar constituency, but also we made a lot of hay out of that remark. But we have started mapping politicians that have solar and don't. It's a complex issue. You'll talk to... It's difficult to do and do it fairly, but we have started to do it. Some, you know, I spoke to one politician who had it, and then, you know, he had some complications with the system, had to take it down at his own cost, and, you know, can you give someone, you know, a rating based on that? So it's a tricky one for us. And Sally, we'll just move to your last question and we'll finish off.
To Paul, about coalitions, remembered listening to Janet Cherry at Breakthrough talking about building a broad coalition between, I guess here it would be Greens, Left, Unions, academics, and to bring down apartheid. And you guys are powerful, and I'm wondering if you could speak to the challenges about building an effective coalition, because we might be in almost the same position if we've got the emissions in Galilee could... bring down the entire global carbon budget?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely crucial to work in coalitions. When we look at the scale of some of the challenges that we're currently facing, it's certainly the case that I don't think any one organisation, particularly when we're thinking in the context of climate and the environment and so forth, has the power in themselves to solve the problem. And if they did, I sure wish they would use it right now, and so we could move on to something else. So, you know, coalition is key, and it's been a big journey for our organisation to get better at working in coalitions, that's for sure. I think it was probably a bit abstract, but that's, you know, in the past, GetUp would see itself specifically as an organisation that would look for tipping point moments and, in a sense, therefore not be so focused on working in coalitions and partnerships. When we were set up, you know, a decade or so ago, that was sort of the niche role that the founders sort of would see that we would set to mobilise lots of people from the outside. So we didn't see any role for GetUp in policy or lobbying or necessarily even in long-term partnerships. And that's been a big change for us, I would say, over the last 5 years. And the Roof campaign is another example of that, where we've worked, with essentially a dozen organisations. We've funded three different NGOs to take five different court cases, and we've worked with a coalition of the other environment groups who work on the issue, and we've worked with the union movement and so forth. And I think the same is needed here. And I think it's also essential when we're looking at an issue that impacts on so many parts of society, as climate change does, but then there's also the part of this issue that impacts on communities that work in the fossil fuel sector, for instance, or the traditional owners on whose land both the fossil fuel industry is being carried out. And so we put a lot of support and energy into making our partnership, for instance, with the Wangan and Jangalingu people, the traditional owners of the Galilee Basin, a big part of our campaign up there, and see that as an essential part of what we do. And likewise, it's one of the things that, as we've been thinking about policy that I've continued to raise, which I'm glad to see is in the top 10, is to think about the opportunities for traditional owners and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities, because you know, there could be nothing worse to sort of turbocharge this boom in renewable energy and have Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people left behind again. So I think coalition is key.
Coalition and collaboration networks and talking and keeping on doing it after the big polling day. So I'm going to wrap up this session. Thank you very much for a really engaged discussion. Big round of applause to our panellists, John, Paul and Cam, who've taken time out of very busy schedules to be here this weekend.